second last song, if you really listen to them words, it says, tell my story. Every one of you have a story that you could tell. You know, and because we just take for granted God at times. And we just forget to thank him for what he does. And then the other part of that song, you know, it says, in the name of Jesus. You know, whenever we pray, you know, sometimes we like to add little fancy things or whatever with it. But the main thing is you pray that in the name of Jesus. So, this morning, I'm just going to open with a little bit of prayer. And we come before the Lord this morning. We praise him and we thank him. Father, we just thank you for this day, Father. We thank you that you gave us the opportunity that we can come into your storehouse and hear your word, Father. So now, Father, this morning, I just ask the blessing upon this service, and people would open up their hearts and receive what the Lord has for us today. And I pray us in Jesus' name. Now, I was going to give the whole message this morning, but I got bumped. So I guess I can yield to this man, because he has a lot more knowledge than I have of his word. So this morning, we're going to listen to Dr. Jerry Savell first, and then I'll come up afterwards and see if I can add anything to what he has to say. Yeah. So, sound team, will you play that video that we have this morning?
Final session, we're talking about a call to action, and this actually came from a very interesting experience that I had way back in 1981. In 1981, and Joe McCroskey, who's here, is my cousin, my international director, but in those days, Joe was our general manager here at the ministry. And he can testify to this. 1981, we were going through probably the toughest time financially that we'd ever experienced as a ministry. You know, from time to time, ministries experience those kind of things. I've sat on the board of directors of a number of ministries and remember times when they'd call special meetings and it'd all be about praying and believing God for his wisdom and how we can get out of. We were going through probably the toughest time financially that we'd ever experienced as a ministry. You know, from time to time, ministries experience those kind of things. I've sat on the board of directors of a number of ministries and remember times when they'd call special meetings and it'd all be about praying and believing God for his wisdom and how we can get out of this financial crisis. Well, we were having one at that time that was probably the toughest time that I'd ever experienced up to that time. And a lot of things we were praying about. We were needing direction from the Lord. And Brother Copeland was doing his Believers Convention in Charlotte, North Carolina, in October of that year. I went into that convention, and I preached all of his Believers Conventions, but I went into that convention, even though I'm a speaker, I went into that convention with a lot of pressure on me. And in the natural, you know, it'd been easier just sit in a room, cry, and you know, and let Carolyn just rub my brow and tell me what a sweet husband I was and a, you know, a darling Christian, you know, and just tell people, figure it out yourself. Man, I got trouble of my own, you know. But, you know, the Bible says be instant in season and out. So even though this seemed like a out of season time, I was determined that I was going to preach the Word of God without compromise. My situation had no bearing on whether or not the Word of God is true. In fact, I knew it's true, and it's just a matter of time. But hey, God, we could use some help right now, you know. And so going into that meeting, like I said, I had a lot of pressure on me. But nobody could tell it. I mean, I went out there, the Bible says, Paul says, a spiritual man is judged by no one. The Savelle paraphrase, keep them guessing, you know. And so I went out there and preached just as boldly and, you know, as powerfully as I possibly could. And we were having great meetings and so forth. And by Thursday afternoon, when I got through preaching, Carol and I went back to our hotel room, and Brother Copeland always furnishes us with a wonderful suite. And so we went back to our hotel room, and I was tired. I mean, if you've ever been in a believer's convention by Thursday, if you've been in every session, you need some relief, you know. And so I was tired. Carolyn was tired. And I just got through preaching that last afternoon service. And Carolyn said, I'm going to go lay down in the bedroom and take a nap. She said, if I don't take a nap, I'm not going to be able to keep my eyes open while Brother Copeland preaches tonight. She said, are you going to come take a nap? I said, no, you go ahead. Just shut the door, and I'm just going to sit here in the living room and just relax. And I said, I might even order some room service. I don't know, but I'm just going to sit here and relax and until time for the service. So Carolyn went into the bedroom, and I took my suit off. I hung it up, and I put on my robe. And I'm sitting there on the sofa in this suite. I even propped my feet up on the coffee table in front of me, and I took my hands and put them behind my head and just leaned back on that sofa and just closed my eyes, not asleep, but I just closed my eyes just to relax for a few moments. And when I did, something happened that I never expected, I never asked for, I didn't know it was going to happen, I didn't pray for it, but the Shekinah glory of God completely filled my room in the form of a cloud so thick that I could not see the furniture any longer. And Jesus appeared in that cloud and began to talk to me. When he did, I had a legal pad over here on this end table, and I grabbed it real quick in my pen, and I started writing everything he said. Now, it seemed like to me he was in there for hours, but it was just moments, which tells me that Jesus can say more in a couple of moments than most preachers can in a lifetime, you know. And I filled up that legal pad with what he said. And then he left. But the cloud was still there. And Carolyn opened the door and said her opening remarks, even though I couldn't see her, I heard her open the door. She said, what's going on in here? It had awakened her. And she came in. I said, Carolyn, I've just had a visitation from the Lord. And I thought it was interesting what Carolyn said, because it's different than what most other people say when they hear me tell this story. Carolyn said, what did he say? Most people want to know, what did he look like? See, I wasn't so much interested, and neither was Carolyn, in what he looked like than what he said. Because it's not what he looked like that was going to make the impact. It was what he said was going to make the impact. And here's what he said to me. He said, my people are in financial famine. Now, I'd never heard that phrase before. He said, my people are in financial famine. Not just you, but the majority of my people are in financial famine. And he said, and I'm going to reveal to you the keys that will bring them out. Not only that, I'm going to hold you responsible for sharing this everywhere you go. And then he began to talk to me about how to come out of financial famine. And it was just absolutely amazing, the things that he taught me in that visitation. So Carolyn said, are you going to tell Brother Copeland about this? I said, I am not. Now, normally, Brother Copeland would have been preaching that night service. And I said, I'm not saying a word to him about it. So we got dressed in a little while, and we went over to the meeting, took my position on the front row next to Gloria. Carolyn was next to me, Charles and Peggy Capps, and Norval Hayes. And Brother Copeland went up to the platform. He opened the service, And then he began singing a few songs. And when he got through singing, you know, the songs, then he said, let's open our Bibles. And he laid his Bible open like this and just looked at it and didn't tell us where to open. We're all sitting there with anticipation. Where do we open our Bibles to? But he just looked at his, grabbed the side of that pulpit, and just looked at it and didn't say another word. Then I saw his thumbs doing like this. And I said, God's saying something to him. And he said, let's open our Bibles. And then he looked back down at his, and those thumbs started moving again. And he said, Jerry, God visited you today. Come tell us what he said. I got up and I walked up to the platform. Brother Copeland asked his associate, Billy Rash, Billy, bring me a chair. And Billy set that chair about, you know, less than 8 feet from the podium. And Brother Copeland sat down in it. And as I was coming up, he grabbed me by the coattail just as I was started to the pulpit. I turned around and looked at him. He said, you tell us everything Jesus told you and don't you leave out a word. You understand me? I said, yes, sir. And I started preaching that night on a message that Jesus called Sowing in Famine. And I preached that message, and the Lord had said to me in my room before going over there, he said, I want you to sow in famine tonight to demonstrate what I'm saying is so. Now, I didn't know I was going to be preaching. He said, I want you to write a check for $1,000 out of every outreach of your ministry and $1,000 out of your personal account, and you sow it into Kenneth Copeland Ministries, sow in famine. Now, I had 10 major outreaches, my television, my missions, Bible schools. I had 10 major outreaches. And he said, sow $1,000 out of each outreach. So that's $10,000. Somebody said, well, $10,000 doesn't sound like famine to me. It does when you need about $1 million. You know, I mean, $1,000 in one of them was my aviation account. And I had $1,000 left in my aviation account. I had given my airplane away. I was believing for my next airplane. And I had $1,000 in my aviation account. You can't buy a lawnmower with wings for $1,000, you know. And so he said, sow $1,000. When I sowed the $1,000 out of my aviation, that depleted that account. He said, sow $1,000 out of television. Sow $1,000 out of mission. Sow $1,000, all 10. So I sat there and I wrote a check for $1,000 out of every outreach. And then Carol and I, we were believing God at that time to build our home, which we presently live in. And he said, sow $1,000 out of your personal account. So we wrote a check out of our personal account for $1,000. I took over to that meeting that night 11 checks, 10 from the ministry and one from my personal account. And as soon as I had an opportunity, I was going to walk up to Brother Copeland and sow each one of those checks individually. Now, the Lord taught me this sowing and famine principle from Genesis chapter 26. Now, we've already talked about it in a previous session, where Isaac sowed in that land. And let me remind you what it says. And he reaped in the same year 100-fold.
Yes. Amen.
The same year. And the Lord said to me, you sow out of your famine into this ministry $1,000 out of each outreach and $1,000 out of your personal account, and I will give you the blessing of Isaac.
My Lord.
I will see to it 100-fold returns to you in the same year. This is October. October. Amen. Now, Joe, you were the general manager, and you can testify to this. So as soon as I got through preaching, I mean, there was such a powerful anointing in that place. I don't know if we even still have the DVDs of it, but it was so powerful. I mean, you could tell that it was a word from heaven for that congregation. I mean, thousands of people in that meeting were in famine. And I turned to Brother Copeland, and I said, now here's what God told me to do. I said, stand up, sir. He stood up, and I said, this is $1,000 I'm sowing in famine out of my aviation, $1,000 out of mission, $1,000 out of television, $1,000 out of this, $1,000 out of that. And not only that, $1,000 out of my personal account, because Carol and I are believing God to build our dream home. And we don't have the money to do it in the natural. And we sowed $1,000. Well, as soon as I did that, people started jumping up out of the audience and sowing their seed, bringing it to the platform. And it looked like everybody in there started bringing their seed to the platform. And it was an amazing anointing. And then the Lord said, tell them this, three things. Number one, I am commanding my blessing upon them. I'm rebuking the devourer for their sake. And I'll give them the blessing of Isaac 100-fold in the same year. Wow. Now that took some boldness to say that, because it's October. In the same year. The next week, I went to Tulsa, Oklahoma to preach in a meeting with Kenneth Hagin. The first night, I walked into that auditorium and a couple came up to me and said, Brother Jerry, God has been talking to us and told us to sow this check into your television ministry. And it was for $100,000. The first $100,000 check we'd ever received. It didn't take a whole year, a week. 1 week and $100,000. The next night, Kenneth Hagin gave me his airplane, which was worth over $175,000. In two nights, I'm reaping 100-fold. Before December the 31st, I had reaped 100-fold on every one of those $1,000 checks. And God honored his word. And then he said, I'm holding you responsible for preaching this everywhere you go. I went to South Africa, and in South Africa at that time, and at the end of 1981, the rand there was almost useless. The dollar to the rand, which is their currency, was amazing. Their money was almost useless. And I'm preaching in a convention where there's about 10,000 people who are all in financial famine, the majority anyway. And I preached this message there, and when I got through, thousands of people began to sow out of famine. And Pastor Ray McCauley told me later, called me after the meeting was over, said, we've had the greatest financial miracles our ministry's ever had. People in our church are calling and saying they've had the greatest financial breakthroughs they've ever experienced. God was honoring his word. He commanded his blessing upon them. He rebuked the devourer for their sake, and he gave them the blessing of Isaac. And we had testimonies in our files throughout 1982. I'm telling you, where I had preached it all over the world, where people were coming out of financial famine because they were willing to be obedient to the word of the Lord. Amen. And then the Lord gave me this word for 1982. He said, during 1982, he said, tell the people something new in 82, financially free by 83. Praise God. And that is exactly what happened to a lot of people all over the world. In fact, I still get testimonies from people who heard me preach on sowing and famine and telling me that didn't tell me way back then what God had done for them. Now, Brother Copeland told his television department, whatever you've got scheduled for our broadcast over the next few weeks, cancel it and get this message Jerry just preached on our Believer's Voice of Victory. So in about 4 weeks, that message came out on Brother Copeland's Sunday broadcast. Back then he wasn't doing weekly or daily, just weekly. It aired on a Sunday. On Monday morning, I get a call from Oral Roberts. And he said, I want you to come to my office and preach that message you just preached on Kenneth Copeland's broadcast and preach it to me just like you did to that audience. I flew to Tulsa, and I went into Brother Roberts' office, and Brother Roberts always did us this way. When he heard a message that inspired his faith and he wanted to hear it again, you walked into his office and he handed you a piece of chalk and you stood in front of a chalkboard and you wrote all the scriptures you're going to talk about and the three main points you were going to cover. And he'd say, now you preach it just like you did on that television broadcast. Don't you leave one thing out. I preached Oral Roberts on sowing and famine for over 6 hours, because he kept interrupting me and asking me questions. He called it an oral exam. Okay? That's what he called it. For 6 hours, I preached on sowing and famine to Oral Roberts. And when I got through, he stood up, threw his arms around me, and he said, "You've heard from God. This is a message from heaven, and I'm going to act on it right now. I'm sowing in my famine." And then he said, "You going to write a book on this?" I said, "I intend to." He said, "You better do it quick, because I'm about to." And I produced a book called Sowing in Famine, and Oral Roberts preached the same message in his book and called it Attack Your Lack. Amen. And it's gone around the world. Now, I'm sharing that story with you because there's still a lot of God's people in financial famine.
Amen.
And I believe the Word, you know, can do the same now, years later, that it did when it was first pronounced.
Amen.
Isn't that true?
Amen.
Because aren't you and I still acting on things that were written years and years, hundreds, thousands of years ago?
Amen.
I'm still getting results that Paul got on, you know, words from God that he got hundreds and hundreds of years ago. Amen. So the Word knows no boundaries. The Word knows no limits. So I want to encourage you, if you're experiencing financial famine in your life, in your business, in your ministry, then you pray about where to sow a seed specifically, a significant seed specifically for coming out of financial famine. Get the book and get that last chapter. Read that last chapter again. And if I were you, I would take a seed. And I'd say, "Father, I'm acting on that prophetic word that you gave Brother Jerry back in October of 1981. And I am sowing in my famine. And I'm expecting the same results that you promised that crowd back there in 1981. That I will have your blessing commanded upon me. You will rebuke my devourer for my sake. And you will give me the blessing of Isaac in the name of Jesus."
Amen.
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 I'm telling you, God's Word knows no boundaries. It knows no limits. And I believe the same blessing awaits you that awaited us when God gave me this Word many, many years ago.
Hallelujah.
Amen. We don't have to live in famine. If we're obedient to the Word of God, God will deliver us. God will take us out. God will put you on a plane that you've never been on before. And I'm not talking airplane. I'm talking level. Praise God. Amen. Our ministry came out of that worst crisis we had ever experienced in 1981. And God was gracious to us. Hallelujah. Amen. You receive that today? That's the call to action. Praise God. Don't just tolerate famine. Don't just, you know, moan and groan and pity yourself about famine. Take action. Do something about it. Sow a seed specifically and call it my sowing in famine seed. Amen. And dare to believe for the same results that we experienced way back there when God first gave me that prophetic word. I believe it's still alive and operative today. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Praise God. And now I want to encourage you that watching the DVDs or listening to it by CD, you're involved in taking this curriculum. If you're in financial famine, then I'm calling you to action. I'm not telling you you have to sow it in our ministry. You pray about where God wants you to sow that significant seed specifically for coming out of famine. And you just watch and see what God will do. Your best days are not behind you. They're just ahead of you. This concludes our study on why God wants you to prosper. Did anybody learn anything?
Amen.
Praise God. Thank you so much, audience, for being here with us. Thank you, students, for taking the curriculum. And I believe your life will never be the same. Amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord another shout of praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. All right, let's make a final confession. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
For blessing me.
For blessing me.
Favoring me.
Favoring me.
Bringing prosperity
and success
into my life. And I'm declaring my days of famine and lack and want are over in Jesus' name. And give Him your best shout. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Wow, that's quite a message that Jerry has. You know, and I'm going to expound on it a little bit. You know, I believe that most of you people in this congregation are not living in financial famine. I don't believe that. Maybe you are, But if you are, Jerry's gave you a solution. But, you know, there's other areas of famine in your life. And he gave us a way out of that. He's telling us what we could do to get out of that also. Where may be our famine in your life? If you have a business, maybe things are kind of slow and not going so well, and maybe a lot of expenses coming on. That's a famine there. You need to sow to get. Maybe just your place of employment. You've been working there, and you feel you're doing a great job and everything, but you're not increasing. You're just stagnant there. You know, the boss don't see what a great employee you are to give you a raise. That's a famine. Maybe you want to sow into that.
Amen.
Or maybe in your marriage. Maybe things are going on in your marriage. You know, things can be happening there. You know, maybe you need to plant a seed for results there, for a breakthrough there. You know, and maybe with your children, maybe with your family, whatever it may be. There's different areas of famine, you know, other than just financial. So you should be, take Jerry's advice. You know, you heard his results there and how many days, how quickly things turned around for him. You know, and you know, we look at those ministries, you know, look at Jerry Savelle, Creflo Dollar, Kenneth Copeland and that, and you think, oh yeah, they got all this. They got all this money. You heard Jerry what he went through. You know, he God speaks to those guys, and they just don't hoard it in their little ministry within their little congregation. They reach out. They're spreading, you know, and to the different ministries. And this church does that. You know, we sow into other ministries and on a monthly basis on what the income here as a church is, and you know. And we've seen results by sowing into those different things and how it's increased for this church. So one of the things, you know, go back to financially, if there's a famine there, you know, if the church has a need and has to do something, maybe just to meet expenses or to expand or whatever, wouldn't it be really nice and say, you could come up to the pastor and say, Pastor, what is actually the need here? How much do we need to do this or do that? And you could say, here's a check. I can cover that. I can do that. You know, and you know, some you think, oh, that's going to really make me short. But God will more than take care of you. He'll take care of you. So I just want to cover a couple other things this morning. In Ephesians 1, it says, as long as our God rebukes the devourer and commands blessing upon us, there's nothing the devil can do to keep us in bondage. Yeah, I will command my blessings upon the people. That's what the Lord says. And that's what he's telling us. He will command his blessings upon us. The Lord will command the blessings. This is Deuteronomy 28:8. The Lord will command the blessings on you in your storehouse and all which you set your hand to. And he'll bless you in the land which the Lord your God gives you. You know, he says he'll bless us in our storehouse. What is your storehouse? Your home is your storehouse. Your family is your storehouse. He'll bless you in those things. You know, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form, void in darkness, and was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the faces of water. And then God said, let there be light, and there was light. Now, what kind of man is that? You know, he said, let there be light, and there is light. What kind of man is that? That's our God. That's our God. And you know, you can go into the Bible, and you can find other instances where he has commanded things, and it happened. So that's our God. We should, you know, we should never think that our God can't do it. He can do anything. Psalms 148, 5 and 6 says, let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. He also established them forever and ever. He made a decree which shall not pass away. And in Isaiah 52 it says, why when I came was there no man? Why when I called was there none to answer? Is my hand shortened at all that it cannot redeem, or I have no power to deliver it? Indeed, with my rebuke I dry up the sea. I make the rivers in the wilderness. Their fish stink because there is no water, and I die of thirst. Again, he's saying, you know, is there anything that I can't do? Do we have faith and trust in him that he, you know, whatever your need is or whatever your problem, whatever your mountain is, that he can take care of it? This tells me, his word tells me that he can do all things. Nothing is impossible for him. So we need not to shortchange God ever. And Mark 4:41 says, and they feared exceedingly and said to one another, who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him? Again, what kind of man is that? You know, speak to the sea, speak to the wind, and it obeys. That's the kind of God we have. That's our God. Malachi 3:11-12 says, and I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And all nations will call you blessed, for you will be a delightful land, say the Lord of hosts. That word rebuke means to express sharp, stern disapproval or reproof or reprimand. You know, when God says, I'm going to command my blessings upon my people, you know he's going to do it, because he has rebuked the devourer for your sake already. So we don't have to take that care upon us. We just need to cast that care upon him, and he'll take care of it. He says, if I talk to you about financings, I'm going to command blessings upon your finances. So, and if the enemy is coming against you in different directions, and you know the enemy will do that. He'll come at you at all different directions. He says, I'm going to command a blessing upon you. Amen. You know, every time you take a step out and expand yourself, you know who's right there alongside you? The enemy. He's going to do something to try to cut your blessings short. You know, and times things happen. You know, good things happen to good people at times. You know, and the enemy is there, and if we aren't strong enough to come up and fight against them, like right now, I got something going on with my blood. I don't, you know, and I know it's just the enemy is trying to attack, you know, to bring an attack upon me. But I'm not going to take it, you know. I'll give it over to God, and God will take care of it. So when he rebukes them, God is addressing them very sharply. You know, the enemy can no longer have control over you. If you let our God do things. When God rebukes, all hell trembles. That voice that Jesus describes, he kind of describes it like, I don't know if any of you ever been to where there's a waterfall and you hear the rushing of water. It makes quite a noise, don't it? That's kind of like God's voice. It's like if you've been to a sporting event or any other event where they have the flyover of the jets, it gets pretty loud. That's God's voice. That when you that rumble, that's how God rebukes the enemy. How he takes care of the enemy. So, you know, that's the kind of authority that God carries. That's the weight of his voice. When he speaks, the enemy trembles. John 12:29 says, therefore the people who stood by and heard it, they heard God's voice, they said it sounded like thunder. And then when God's voice speaks like that, he's rebuking Satan. And so as long as God rebukes the devourer and commands blessing upon us, there's nothing the devil can do to keep us in bondage. He'll take care of it. The word devourer in the dictionary says to eat up greedily, or to use or destroy or to prey upon. You see what the devil has been doing in your finances, in your family life. You know, he's been swallowing those things up. He wants to destroy them. But if we live on our faith and step out in our faith, God will take care of that. It says, so God will rebuke the devourer for our sakes. Now, he also tells us that people should sow in famine. You should. That's what, if you go to the different stories in the Bible, you'll see when there was famine in the land, there was sowing done. And the enemy was rebuked. He says when the enemy is coming against us, if we command his blessings, he'll take care of things. Whether it be a financial condition or sickness or problem in family life, he'll take care of it. He'll change things for you. He says, you know, when he tells us to sow, right away we think, oh, if I sow, I'm going to be short. But especially if there's a famine, if there's a time where the enemy is attacking you, that's the time when you really need to be sowing to do that. And I was just, as listening to Jerry's DVD, how he said how he sowed those, he had those 11 checks that he sowed. And the part that I liked was when he said, you know, he took a check from each one of the different divisions of his ministry, but then he said he took one from his personal.
Yes.
And, you know, whenever I and Pastor Jan go to any of those meetings with Copeland Dollar, Creflo Dollar, or whoever it is, we never neglect to sow from our personal.
Amen.
You know, it doesn't matter what we may have facing us as far as financially, we always sow personally into that ministry. And we've been blessed over and over many times, you know. You know, God is so good. He's so good to us. You know, we go to those things and we can do that. We can sow. I don't know how long it's been since I have not got a salary from my business or anything. But we can go and do these things yet because God financially blesses us by being obedient to what God wants us to do. Proverbs 11:24 says, one person gives freely yet gains even more. Another one holds unduly but comes to poverty. A time of famine is not the time to hold on to the little bit you have. You know, that little bit you have is not going to take care of your need anyway. So if you sow it and believe in God's word, the devourer will be, you know, that devourer, he can't touch you. He can't come and take what you have. You know, he's going to get you out of that famine. God's going to get you out of that famine. So, in Genesis 26, that's the year that Isaac's, the blessing that was put upon Isaac. And if you go and read that whole story and see what all happened in there, how he was blessed with his crops, his animals, and everything. And because, you know, Isaac, he didn't run and fret. You know, he stayed put in that time of famine because Jesus had spoke to him and told him he was supposed to stay. He wasn't supposed to run. You know, right away, we want to, when something comes up, we want to run, we want to scatter every direction. We think, oh, I can take care of this myself. I can do it. But we need to stay put and stay on God's word. And that blessing that came upon Isaac will come upon you. So, you know, don't you want Isaac, the blessing of Isaac? Don't, you know, we don't have to run all over the place. So, you know, success to one person may not mean success to another. You know, like I was saying, the success that I and Pastor Jan probably means nothing to any of you other people, you know, but it means a lot to us. So success to one person may not mean success to another. You know, go back to the DVD. Jerry believed when God spoke to him in that room, he believed that the blessing was going to come upon him. That's how he was able to go preach that and preach and believe that that was going to happen. And you've seen how shortly it happened, how quickly it happened to him. You know. So God can use you. You know, he can use you to be example for somebody else.
Yes.
You know, and I've seen that. I've seen God use people, and it was a good example to somebody else, but it was also an example to me. Hey, God's word doesn't go void. He's going to do what he says. So God can use you as an example. Today I'm going to tell you God will use you, and he'll put the blessing, that blessing of Isaac upon you also, just like he, you know, just like it happened to Jerry. The blessing came upon him. That can happen to you too. I'm going to also include a little bit more besides what I got all out of listening to Jerry and listening to his DVDs. You know, ever since Jerry came to here and took him to the Packer game, he's kind of become my favorite preacher to listen to. So I don't know why, but yes, I think he has a really strong word from the Lord. And the other thing is, you're around him, that kind of rubs off on you. Kind of rubs off on you. Just like when we was to Copeland at Chicago, I don't know how many you were here Wednesday night when Del Rose and Terry's the newsman from Channel 5, they were here. They had come down to Chicago for the meeting there with Copeland. I don't know who they talked to. I think they talked to Michael Flowers. I think they talked to, and they got the last meeting, they got to sit in the front row. They actually got to sit in the seats that I and Pastor Jan had been sitting in up to that time, to that last meeting. They got to sit right there. And Copeland is preaching, and he gets pretty close to you when you're in that front row. So he's preaching, and he's walking towards Terry and Del Rose, and she has a little bottle of water. And she offers him the bottle of water. And he takes the bottle of water, and he takes a couple of drinks out of it. And so how do you say that? He says, I may be back to get more or whatever. But anyway, Del Rose has that little bottle of water that he drank out of. So the anointing from Copeland is on that, and that anointing is going to come upon those people, you know. So Exodus 35:4-5 says that Moses spoke to all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, this is the thing which the Lord commanded, saying, take from among you an offering to the Lord, whoever is of a willing heart. There's the key. Whoever is of a willing heart. You know, if you come on Sunday, Wednesday, whatever, and you bring an offering or your tithe or whatever, and you're grudgingly doing it, you know, that's not doing anything for you, because you might as well keep it in your pocket as to give it to the offering or the tithe to the Lord, because he knows your heart. So the key to that is do it with a willing heart. Let him bring in an offering to the Lord with a willing heart. That's what we need to do. Our heart needs to be willing to do things. God wants us to act on our faith voluntarily. He doesn't want to put pressure on you that you have to do it, that you have to do this, you got to do that. He wants you to voluntarily do it and act on your faith. Again, so out of a need for then the gospel can be spread around the world. If you're sowing out a need, you sow it into a ministry that you know it's being sown into good ground, that the word is being preached and taught, and it's going out to increase the kingdom of God. So that's what you want to be doing. God promises that you will reap a bountiful harvest. Did Jerry kind of reap a bountiful harvest in that short time? And so now, he did it for Jerry, didn't he? If he did it for Jerry, he can do it for me. He can do it for you. He can do it because God is not a respecter of persons. So he'll do it for anybody. So the thing that we need to do, you know, one time you give an offering and nothing happens. Because we're such an impatient people. And we do it. And then the other thing is, I give an offering, and then I don't wait to hear from God what he actually has for me. You know, you all can hear from God, but you have to be quiet to hear from God. You know, was it quiet, quickly and quietly? Sometimes you need to just be quiet and wait on the Lord, and He'll show you. He'll tell you where to go, what to do, you know. So don't make it a one-time thing that you give an offering one time and you think everything's going to be all changed around. You need to wait on the Lord. And you notice something? The Lord knows. He may bless you, but He also knows. He knows where your heart is. And if He blesses you with a windfall of income, He knows which people He can do that to, because He knows some people can't handle it and what they will do with it. So, again, make sure you don't do it one time thing for it. God wants the opportunity to command His blessing upon you, just like the blessing was upon Isaac. God wants that opportunity to do it for you. Again, if he's done it for some, He'll do it for others, because He's not a respecter of people. So what he's done for others, He'll do for us. So I hope that helps you this morning. That's a little bit what I have. We're going to take up our offerings, our tithes and our offerings. Deb's going to come, the worship team. You know something, Deb, I don't know if you got to hear last week's music. Some guy really got anointed last week. And, man, I'm waiting to see that again from him. Well, we don't. That wasn't country, but, man, you were anointed. You were anointed.
Well, did you see it?
No, but I know what's on the list. I know what they played. So.
Well, sometimes he's up here just going through the motions, but last week the Lord touched him in a big way, and he was really anointed.
Maybe I need to leave more often.
What's that?
Maybe I need to leave more often. Yeah. Just let Aaron do that.
But anyway, you need to listen to the DVD so you hear what an anointed man you have.
They don't record that.
No. Don't you guys record that?
Not the music.
You know something? When you see a special anointing upon a leader like that, that's, you guys should recognize that and record it. What are you saying?
Live stream it.
Oh, live stream. Okay. All right. Anyway, Deb, why don't you lead up? I'm going to ask the ushers come and release you row by row as we bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord.
Did you want to sing with us?
Yeah.
More than I could hope or dream of, You have poured Your favor on me. One day in the house of God is better than a thousand days in the world. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I've got to give it away. Your love taught me to live now. Enough for me. More than I could hope or dream of, You have poured Your favor on me. One day in the house of God is better than a thousand days in the world. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I've got to give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I've got to give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me.
supposed to pray over our offering this morning. Stretch your hands forward.
Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give today so we can prosper your kingdom. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now, Aaron and Judy, you can be released. Debbie, I want you to stay here a minute. We're going to change things up a little bit. You know, you guys all kind of get into a routine, so I'm going to change things up a little bit this morning. You can be seated. Debbie, I want you to call your son Keegan up here.
Okay.
And I want you to share what was in the paper.
Oh, okay.
Keegan, come on up here. I seen this here, and you can't believe how proud I was.
Me too.
And Grandma too.
So it was not in the paper. It was actually...
Turn me off.
It's a paper.
It's a Kimberly school newsletter. And we didn't actually know it was going to be in there. I knew that he had accomplished this. I knew that they took his picture. Then they put it up on the wall at school, but I didn't know that they were going to have it in the newsletter. So Kim had seen it and posted it on Facebook, and I'm like, what's that? Because I don't read the newsletter because he's not in the Kimberly school anymore, so there's no reason for me to really go through that. But Keegan had accomplished, he had completed the Microsoft Office class at Kimberly High School. And about two months after you completed that class, we got an email from the teacher and said, you can get certified in all of these different segments of Microsoft Office. So that opportunity had come up, and you know, we said, you should do this. So he went ahead and worked at that every night after school. He would have a little bit of time after school because, you know, he had to wait till the classes were all done. The teacher had, like maybe an hour from 3 o'clock till 4 o'clock to that he could come. He had to, you know, study for each of these classes, and he would have to do the studying. If he didn't finish studying it, he'd have to come back the next day, and then the next day, and then he'd go back and take the test. And so he worked at it real consistently, real quickly, and he actually completed all four segments of the Microsoft Office certification. What were those certifications?
PowerPoint, Excel, Access, and Word.
So they took his picture with the four certificates. And he was the first one to complete all those certifications. And I think up until this point, he's the only one who has actually completed all four of those certifications. And he did it very quickly. God gave him favor.
And quietly.
Yeah, he's pretty quiet. He says he doesn't talk to anybody really at school.
He's going to learn.
So that was a blessing. And I thought Amen. That was favor. So I went and printed that out of the newsletter. So we can add that to his thing for graduation.
Amen.
Amen.
It is good.
Amen. 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 The ushers are going to pass out the communion, and we're going to take communion. You're going to come do the communion? Hey, that's your pain this week.
And quietly, how I was obedient, I almost missed it. Oh my. You know what I really like, Pastor Kenny, when Jerry was saying here, all God wants is an opportunity to command his blessings upon you and to rebuke the devourer for your sake. That's what giving tithing offerings is. Do you realize that? What a way. I mean, can the heaven and God, can the heavens, okay, how do you say this here? Do you know how, with the world's going and blah, 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 and everything they're saying, your 401ks and all this here, really, you're not going to have anything. That's because that's what the government's doing, right? But God, he's got it on a different level. So what the world's telling you, you go, I don't think so. I'm standing on God's level because I have a covenant, and this is proof of the covenant. I eat the bread and I drink the wine, which is juice. I drink it because I have a covenant, and God is waiting for an opportunity to rebuke the devourer and command the finances to come to us so that we can brag on him, and he can use us, as it says in 2 Corinthians 2:14. What is he doing with us? He holds us up as a trophy. Do you think God is holding Jerry up as a trophy? Oh, Father, I thank you now in the name of Jesus. Now, Father, we break this bread because Jesus' bread, oh, his body was broken. I thank you, Father God, for the opportunity to sow our money, just like we did. That's sowing us. We gave ourselves to you. We can give it for our children. We can give it for our grandchildren. We can give it for our marriage. We can give it for our wherever we work. We can give it, even if something isn't working in your home or your car is, we can give to that, and we can receive the blessings of Isaac on there. So, whoops, Father, I thank you for that. Now, we eat this because we have a covenant. We receive your healing. We receive your abundance. We receive favor. We receive it all in Jesus' name. Let's eat. And Father God, the blood. So you said that we look like fire from the loins down and the loins up to the enemy, just like Jesus. And I thank you in the precious name of Jesus. Let's drink our righteousness. I think the biggest thing of all is we have got to learn to receive what God has said for us. And I had written that down. God said, his first one, Jerry was talking about, I will command my blessings upon my people. That's, see, when you pay tithe and give offering, that's what's happening. And number two, let me see, where did I put number two? Number two, I will rebuke the devourer on your behalf, on the behalf of my people. What an insurance we've got like that. You know, it kind of reminds me of, okay, you look at people, look at an army that's going forth. But they've got a cannon, a bazooka, all this kind of machinery, and they come on, and I got one little pistol, you know, and I stand there and I look at them, I'm saying, oh, whatever you want me to do, I'll be glad to do it. That's God. He's got all the ammunition. He's got all the power in this world. We have to take it by faith, and we got to believe it. Oh, and then number three is, my people must sow in famine. So I think this is wonderful for such a time as this to be teaching this. And you don't have to do it if you don't want to, but that's up to you. But I've made a choice to be obedient quickly and quietly. So pray on it, guys. Pray on it, and you can get the CD or the DVD, or what you can do is go online and listen to it again and let your heart take it in. Okay, we're not going to beg you for anything. We're not going to push it onto you. Just let the Holy Spirit take it. Now, Father God, I stand in agreement with each and every one here.
Yes, Lord.
Would you stand? I stand in agreement that each and every one here will listen to my Father God and will take in his promises so that they can have no famine in their finances, in their workplace, in their bodies. Now, famine means weakness, you know, as well. You know that. Like infirmity in the body, that means a weakness, maybe in your finances, maybe in your health, maybe your checking account, okay, let's put it that way. Maybe in your marriage, maybe in your children, maybe in your grandchildren. I don't know. Your animals. I don't know. Just take it by faith. Do you agree? God is looking for a way to rebuke the devourer for your sake. And if you're in a situation like we have gotten in different times, you know what we do? We give our way out. We do. We give our way out. And that's why. What just happened to that, you know? It works. It works. It works. So I plead the blood of Jesus over each and every one of you here. And that you will sit quietly and listen to the Holy Spirit and let him teach you in the sweet name of Jesus. Do you receive it?
Amen.
Good. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.
Just a minute.
I'm sorry, sir.
Just a minute. I got to do the announcements because, and I got to get this right because Kim's here checking on me today. So I got to do the announcements.
Sorry.
Go quickly through these announcements.
Quickly and quietly, I'm going to leave.
So, check out our website.
Yes.
And you're going to find everything on our website that you want to know about this church. And then you can watch the archives on ESCF service on YouTube. So now Kim is Aaron's praise and worship on that?
Yes.
It is. All right. So, well.
Just the message.
Right.
See, what we're going to do is have him do that again. And then Debbie, she's going to be up there, though, too.
All right. Okay. And then this this Thursday is the Women's Bible Study.
Look at
9:30 a.m.
Amen.
And so make sure you're here, gals. Otherwise, the guys are going to have to start coming. Fill up the room, you know.
Bring it
on. And then... May 5th, which is also Thursday, is the National Day of Prayer, also that day. So, you know, we don't have to have a National Day of Prayer. We pray every day. And that's what you should be doing. You shouldn't have to just have a National Day of Prayer. So, and then again, they are enrolling for the Academy, the Covenant Academy. So, word of mouth, it is out on now, advertising on. Had a couple people said they heard the ad on the radio, so that's going. And then, you can mark your envelope for Children's Rescue and slave trafficking. If you, God is leading your heart to do that, mark your envelope and do that too. And you can learn more about that on that Liberty Council website. So next health and wellness class is May 9th, and the theme for that class is get charged. Get charged. So we have to find, if you want to know how to get charged, come in May 9th class. So, okay, then let's go before the Lord and pray for our military and our police.
Yes.
You know, just this week, again, I've seen crazy things. With, you know, I really feel sorry for our police. That stuff that they have to put up with, you know, I don't care what candidate you like or dislike, but I think that's just totally wrong when I see that protesting going on and I see how those protesters are treating the police. I'm afraid if I was in that line, I couldn't restrain what those guys are doing. You know, and then I see them jump on top of a police car, jump up and down on the roof of a police car and dent it in so it popped the windshield and the back window right out of the car, you know. That's totally wrong, and the police have to put up with something like that going on. So
let's put an agreement, because it says if two or more come in agreement,
whatever they agree on, they're going to have it. Now, we've got a powerhouse here, because you guys believe that when you pray, it's guaranteed to come to pass, do you? So say, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
Satan, you get your hands off of our policemen.
Our policemen.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
We've got an agreement, don't we?
Amen.
We've got an
Amen.
Agreement.
Okay. Let's pray for our military.
Father, in Jesus' name, we exercise our covenant authority over the enemy. We demand the
killing, destruction,
and confusion over American soldiers, our police, and all who stand with them to stop now. Charge the angels to protect and guide them. We speak the blood of Jesus and the protection of the 91st Psalm over them now. Jesus is Lord over Iraq, Afghanistan, United States of America, and all of the earth.
Amen.
You know what? Always remember this earth God gave us. God gave us authority on this earth. He gave us authority on this earth. So that means we have authority, whatever happens on this earth. And another thing I want to stop is our soldiers from Vietnam, Iraq, Afghanistan, all those places, there are so many suicides because they're cutting things from these men and women that have served. And when I see that they want to increase our politicians' pay, that makes me real mad. Do you agree it should stop?
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 It's yours.
All right. I'm going to plead the blood of Jesus over each and every one as you go about your day today and the rest of the week, that for the Lord would bless you. And we just ask that protection over each and every one in whatever you're doing. So now, Father, we just thank you for this, and we give you glory. We give you all the honor to you in Jesus' precious name. And something good is going to happen to you today.
Amen.
Amen. You're dismissed.